so different upside down. Right about here, right in Champaign. We were going to go to Boston. Doesn't that sound good? I've never been to Boston. It was going to be great. We were going to see things that we've never seen. I was all excited. And then because of circumstances beyond my control, we went to Florida instead in July. We were right about in this area. And you ever been to Florida in July? It's hot. I hadn't either, and I didn't think it was going to be so great. February, yeah. November, I've been there, yeah. But and I got whiny, crabby, hopefully more inside than out. But sometimes things don't turn out the way you want, right? Sometimes you want this, but you get that. You got a plan over here, and something else happens instead. Have you guys ever been disappointed? Yes. Can you think of a time that you can tell? No. It's just too awful, right? Too tragic. Right? Can you think of anything, Wes? You want to tell me? Keep it in your heart. So this is a Florida story too. You're at Universal Studios at Disney, and tell me again what happened. They replaced the Jaws ride with some Harry Potter thing. Awful, right? So how'd you feel? Are you mad? And sad? Did you scream? Okay, but sometimes you feel like it, right? Sometimes you kind of want to cry about it, and you don't want anybody to see that, but you might. So, sometimes it happens. And I think when those things happen, it's a good opportunity to say, God, help me out here. I'm a little bit worked up, but can you help me calm down and just show me what you want me to do now? And it's usually, I often wish that God would say, Tom, what I want you to do now is just gripe about this for a while. Because God never, ever, 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 ever says that. It's usually something like, look, try to find something good. I'll be with you. It's okay. This is not as big an issue as you thought, and you can make it. So, let's remember that. I need help remembering that, too, because I get kind of peeved when things don't go the way I thought they were going to go. But it's a good opportunity to ask God to help show us what we can do. So, will you pray with me? All right. Help us, God, when we are disappointed, to look to you and find our way forward. Amen. Thanks, you guys. Now we're going to sing that song now while we get in the mood. I'm going to go home. Maybe not. Here it goes.
Thank you. Please join me in a prayer for illumination. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voices of your own, so that we may hear your word and also believe it. In Christ our Lord. Amen. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wonderful works. Glory in his holy name, let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord in his strength, seek his presence continually. Remember the wonderful works he has done, his miracles, and the judgments he uttered. O offspring of his servant Abraham, children of Jacob, his chosen ones, he is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He is mindful of his covenant forever, of the word that he commanded for a thousand generations, the covenant that he made with Abraham, his sworn promise to Isaac, which he confirmed to Jacob as his statute, to Israel as an everlasting covenant, saying, to you I will give the land of Canaan as your portion for an inheritance. Praise the Lord.
Today we hear again a story from the book of Genesis as we make our way through. We don't follow every story, and so this kind of picks up in the middle of things, and I could spend a little while explaining the background, but I'm going to do that afterwards, and so if you just really listen, it'll be okay. You'll get the gist of this, and I'll give you the background afterwards. From Genesis, the 29th chapter, beginning with the 15th verse. You'll notice if you've been hanging around during the summer, some of the names will be familiar, particularly the name Jacob, in Legion, two Sundays ago, as Rabbi. Then Laban said to Jacob, because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be? Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were lovely, and Rachel was graceful and beautiful. Jacob loved Rachel, so he said, I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel. Laban said, it is better that I give her to you than that I should give her to any other man. Stay with me. So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love he had for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife that I may go into her, for my time is complete. So Laban gathered together all the people of the place and made a feast. But in the evening he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and he went into her. Laban gave his maid Zilpah to his daughter Leah to be her maid. When morning came, it was Leah. Jacob said to Laban, what is this that you've done to me? Did I not serve with you for Rachel? Why then have you deceived me? Laban said, this is not done in our country, giving the younger before the first one. Complete the week of this one, and we will give you the other also in return for serving me another 7 years. Jacob did so and completed her week. Then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel as a wife. Written word of God for all God's people.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Okay. So one thing I can say after spending the better part of the summer with these stories from Genesis is that these people are deceptive. They are lying liars somehow. They're jealous and competitive and deceptive. And they're smart and they're dumb, depending. And they seem a lot like some of the people I know, maybe even me. Now, two Sundays ago, Esau sold his birthright to his younger, by what, just a few seconds, younger brother, twin, Jacob, for a bowl of stew. Later on, when their father Isaac was old, Jacob went into his father and with his mother Rebekah's help, tricked his dad into blessing him instead of Esau, after which Isaac appeared to be furious, though some people surmise that maybe he really wanted to bless Jacob anyway, in which case he was as much the deceiver as anybody. So Esau wants to kill his brother. So much for the Bible being filled with pure, morally upright, mild-mannered, self-controlled, and self-sacrificing people. And since Esau is in the mood to kill, and especially given their mother Rebekah, loves Jacob more than she loves Esau, she sends Jacob off to find and marry one of her brother Laban's daughters, of which there are two, Leah and Rachel. According to the story, Leah, the older, has lovely eyes, or if you read some other versions, they will tell you she has weak eyes, which could mean they just aren't that sparkly, or she has a weird eye, or she's just not that pretty. You just pick. Biblical interpretation isn't always easy. Rachel, the younger, on the other hand, is graceful and beautiful, which also can mean a whole lot of different things, all of which, according to the story, have caught Jacob's eye and captured his heart. So grammar, some of you remember from two Sundays ago that that's the meaning of Jacob's name, that he was born literally grabbing the heel of his brother Esau. Grabber has found something that he wants to grab. Any interpretation you make is probably correct. But there's only one thing. He's agreed to 7 years of labor in exchange for Rachel. But no worries, it's okay, he can do it, it's a deal. As the story goes on, so Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love he had for her. Okay, fine, sure. Somebody really asked him how he felt. You know, 2,555 days, more or less, looking at that girl and not touching her. So, how was that, grabber? Oh, it was like a week, maybe a little less. Sure. Maybe. I know this, for once, grabber can't just grab. But here's the thing. The trickster is so enamored, so smitten by the lovely Rachel, that he himself gets tricked. Little payback, some would say. All seems well with his uncle Laban at first greeting when Laban hears Grabber's life story and says in so many words, "Ah, we are family indeed," which just might mean, in other words, "You are a trickster just like me." So, forward the movie to the morning after the wedding. By the way, there's not much talk about the wedding here. In fact, the storyteller spares no words to tell us that Grabber awakens next day, lying next to none other than Leah. The trickster has been treated to a taste of his own medicine. "Oh my boy," Leah says. By the way, they don't do it that way in Grabber's country either, but he doesn't seem to be much for following rules, so he needs to be reminded. And this time, old Grabber is left there without a trick up his sleeve. Nothing at all that will allow him to grab what he wants without a prize. So it's 7 more years. Here, you can have Rachel too, yes, but you'll have to work 7 more years. People are deceptive.